Is ECS season 2 finals here? We are in Anaheim. How are you doing, James?
I am doing fine, yes. I'm doing good. I'm being treated well by the staff here of the ECS finals. They're awesome. So the people of the Anaheim Convention Center, the security, are very nice people indeed. Everyone's nice. That's great. So we're going into the next map. We can see what it is. You can't, because we have a veto overlay. Boom! Veto overlay is coming in. So now you can see what the match is the map is going to be. It's Cloud9 versus FaZe. So we see it's not cobblestone. Boom. Drum roll. Boom, bada, bum, 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 bada, bum, bum, bum.
Is this your...
Boom, bada, bum, bum, bum. It's not cash. Drum roll. Dan, you still tend to do drum roll.
I'm not going to do the drum roll, James.
Why not?
Because I want to talk about these maps.
Are you what?
What? I said I want to talk about the veto.
Okay, go on then.
Well, I think there's a phase in Cloud9. You don't expect them to play some of the slower, more tactical maps in their current iterations, I feel like. And I mean, as we can see with across the dropping process here, we're eventually coming to a situation where... Did they drop cash? Yeah, cash was dropped second by Cloud9. Yes. Interesting, actually. That's an interesting one. Because in a phase with Carrigan, I guess actually lately that has been stepped up massively for the phase side. So it does make a lot of sense. Cloud9, even though, you know, way back when, as a North American team, they were very good on cash. They had a lot of good results there. These days, it has definitely dropped off a lot. So, as you can see, Overpass is going to go away, and that's going to leave us with Mirage.
Nice.
And that's a really cool map for both of these teams to play on. I think we're going to be able to see a lot of cool stuff out of FaZe, especially now that you know, Carrigan is behind the helm. He's got even more time to actually develop some cool stuff. Because Mirage is a map where you can get really interesting strategies going for yourself. And I feel like for quite a while, it was all about getting a structure in, getting the basics down. And I feel like they had enough time with Carrigan now to be able to show us some cool rounds that are better tailored to the FaZe players.
Both teams are ready. We should be into things very shortly indeed. See Carrigan there in the middle. Do you wonder if we'll see the second AWP picked up by Carrigan? Done better with it recently than he has in the previous months, but obviously Alu is the man there. And again, FaZe are a team where, in terms of AWPing output, they were pretty weak on this map in particular, but Alu is much more better suited for Mirage than Fox was.
Yeah, Alu is really, really good on Mirage. He's such a complete AWPer. He's very dynamic. He's very good at reading the game and putting himself in the right spots. And he tends to be quite consistent as well. And that's obviously always going to be an amazing and a very important quality in any AWP player. And FaZe, they've been using him pretty well so far. They've given him a lot of space. And it was one of the things I was talking about previously. When Fox was on the lineup, it really felt like, you know, pre-Carrigan, it felt like he didn't really get to do necessarily all that much. And you just sit there on the CT side, just sitting in middle, get smoked off, not really have much impact after that, and that'd be that. But Ali will see him moving around across the entire map. He was the player that actually, when he went to NIP, he actually brought Mirage into their map pool when it was a map that they never played, just because he was picked up onto the team back in those days. It feels so long ago now. But so yeah, I actually expect FaZe will win this one. I feel like FaZe are going to win this one.
I can't pick a favorite between these two. But I'm very curious to see how it goes down. You see the countdown has begun. Cloud9 starting on the CT side. You see Skadoodle with Grenade and Diffuse Man. Smoke and a Diffuse Kit for him. And Rain has been made the Raider boss. He's got a Tech 9 and he's got Kevlar. Carrigan grenades. So AZ, I believe, has dropped the Tech 9. He's got himself a smoke grenade. So let's see if that Tech 9 can go well for FaZe. Maybe that smoke will help that Tech 9 get into those close quarters engagements.
Good start for Cloud9. Stewie nails Alu. And FaZe will be locked out of connector. That's annoying. That is annoying. You can see they're going to throw their own smoke past it towards the jungle position and run all the way through the smoke. Boom! Split onto the man in CPL. However, the jump was failed, so Skadoodle gets himself an easy kill. And now just madness on the A bomb site. Cloud9 defending well. Just AZ left. And there's not a lot he can do, but two quick pops here, and maybe he's giving himself a chance.
It's really awkward for Automatic to be the trade fragger here. He's got 16 HP, but standing behind the box and doing nothing is not going to help either. Still biding his time. Can Cloud9 make the right play? I think they're banking on a triple peek with Shroud as well. He's over in jungle. And AZ trying to figure out what's what. Will he move and reset the situation? Stewie 2K's moved into an even more superior situation. Now we've got a Stewie Shroud crossfire. Unless AZ looks towards jungle at the right time while he's up on high ground. flying down now. Sui's behind him, and that will be the end of the round. Great play by Sui again. Cloud9, a team very forward-thinking. Here's AZ move away, uses that, exploits that fact to get into a crossfire position with Shroud, and then there is the round.
I almost thought that AZ could pull that one out of the bag, one versus five with a pistol. AZ does crazy stuff with pistols. Crazy stuff with everything. He's a very good player. Especially like seeing him on the rifle, of course, though. But the pistol's out here for FaZe, having been unable to get the bomb plant. The force buy is there. Although Karrigan and Alu indeed saving some cash for the eventual AWP buy on their first buy round. Actually, it's that's kind of interesting that both Karrigan and Alu have P250s. I don't think we're going to see double up on the T side. That would be weird. That would be really weird. Okay, they must have dropped guns to their teammates or something. I'm not sure.
We'll see.
They have no money.
They'll have more money for utility as well. So, see how it goes. So far, nothing doing for FaZe. Three players in the middle area. Opportunities to move into connector. Oh, nothing. That's a good spot to shoulder peek both Palace and the connector. But now he's stuck because he's had his bell rung and he's continuing pre-firing there because he's afraid he's going to go down, and indeed he will. AZ with the second hit shot as well. And now Skididdle has a lot to do. He's at least maiming two of these players. And they're facing him one by one. There's another kill for FaZe. But they've got two players heavily tagged. Four versus two. But Cloud9 still have opportunity here.
Yeah, flash in for Shroud. And that's going to be them understanding exactly where he is now. And they've already got post-plant positions. This is very, very awkward. They have kits, though. All the nades will be used. That should be... Oh, Alu's actually going to be able to survive there. I thought he would actually burn alive, but... He's going to be good to go. Automatic now is going to be moving forwards, finding himself an angle. But Rain, decisive work with the Deagle. Very precise.
One kill for Cloud9 in that round.
That is not good.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate for nothing. Just very bad timing for him. Backing off from connector, getting his bell rung elsewhere. And you see AZ fly in here and finish him off. And that second kill was huge onto Stewie2K, who did have a helmet.
They picked up three UMPs as well. They actually picked up a lot of weaponry here. That is scary for Cloud9. It comes automatic with a very aggressive play, though. Doesn't get much out of it, though, so that's unfortunate for Cloud9. They did invest all their grenades, more or less, in that, so now they have even less to work with, but still trying to be active to try to get something happening for themselves early in this round.
I've got to say, I rarely see that running flashbang yield a kill in the underpass. Often the T's are too far up, and it's where there is a kill from the CTs, it's normally just about a straight duel, and the flashbang doesn't really have much involvement in it. So something to look at there, something to consider. Minute 10 on the clock for the T side, moving around towards A. Just pistols for Cloud9. No grenades. Automatic with Kevlar. Two players in mid. Stu2K spotting information. Can the CTs rotate in time to do some damage?
Looks like he's unable to find anything with his bot shots. Trying his best, but the grenades will now deny vision. And without vision, there is little in opportunity here for the Cloud9 side. Going down one by one now. Nice flash over the top there to help out the FaZe clan, eliminating the rest of these CTs. And looks like it's good. They've managed to do it. And this might even be completely clean. This could end up being... This is almost the worst way you can start a CT side. Win the pistol, then lose the next round, and give away three guns. That is insane.
It is less than ideal, to say the least. Another nothing round. Skididdle, though, his money's in the right place. 3,400 plus will allow him AWP and full armor should he require it. He can skimp on the helmet if he wants to. But... He may not want to, depending on, you know, three UMPs on FaZe. They will have decisions to make as well. If they ever read that Cloud9 won't have the money for helmets, then they may keep those UMPs. So far, so good on this anti eco. Full rotation from Cloud9 with the pistols.
Ooh.
Nice kill from Stewie, and now he's got potential to make some more money for his CT side. Automatic looking for the close ranges as well, and now things are turning into a total mess for the T side. AZ and Kijima remain. AZ was on fire for a brief time, but that Molotov will allow him to get the bomb down.
Yeah, the problem is that they have no armor, and... Okay, Shroud's picked up an AK, but he's got no health. He dies as soon as he gets touched by one of these two T players. He is very dead. He's got no kit as well, so he can't even really afford to go so slowly. Gonna find AZ. He didn't want to jump over the box again with such little health. It's really hard to convert that frag once you've given your position away. Very tough spot for Shroud. But 3-1, they did do some damage, but if you consider how much FaZe have already stolen away from Cloud9 in the previous rounds, they're still looking great.
Interestingly, all those kills from the CT side make it more likely that FaZe will upgrade to helmets, which makes it less of a requirement for, sorry, AKs, which means Cloud9 don't need the helmets as much as they otherwise might. Alu, one of the AWPers who commonly likes to go for that B pick. We see that from JDM as well. And there's another European AWP, I do not recall who. Shroud playing off angles at the moment. And he has support from Skadoodle in the window as well. Nothing with a very forward spawn. But it's still early days. Doesn't want to overcommit just yet.
Yeah, really passive stuff here from FaZe Clan. And you got Cloud9 asking some questions up in middle there. They've got some forward positioning, some information as well with that. But FaZe is coming to a minute, and they have not taken any map control. This is the first that Cloud9 are seeing of FaZe at the moment, is a bunch of nades get thrown into A to look like a set piece onto the A bomb site. But in reality, everybody, including the bomb, is with that B push. It's like Cloud9 are not buying this either. They're just not buying it.
Yeah, it's not often that you see those two smokes around the jungle area. It's not often that you see CTs buying an A push with two smokes when five people are alive. 35 seconds left. Kerrigan picked off top mid. Not much information for Cloud9 from that, but they're just biding their time. And now comes a push from FaZe to gamble into the B bomb site. But Cloud9 have a position on short as well as elsewhere. AZ getting taken down. Ali down to 1 HP. This is falling apart. Rain and Kijimi need to put in work. That's two for them. But now they're at 15 seconds to plant the bomb. And there it goes. I think the bomb might be even irretrievable now. Might be on the roof. But FaZe went for a raw play into the B bomb site, and it has not worked out for them.
Yeah, it's an interesting spot. I think, as you say, it's just Cloud9, they're too good to you know, make a misplay there, caused by that that push in. You know, your A players are just not panicking. They're calling out the info, and no one's going for the rotation straight away. And then after like 5 or 6 seconds, you don't see anything. There's no reason not to just hold your positions. And they were already suspecting B as well because of the presence that was just there. So it worked out very well for Cloud9. Skadoodle goes for a quick flick shot in middle. Doesn't get it. Very fast pace now from FaZe.
Old school FaZe Clan tactics. Normally see Kishima charging in, but Rain's going to be the one to get the first frag through Connector. Very fast in B, but a spray down. Can he get the second kill? 80 down to 8 HP. Stu2k doing the best he can to hold things down here from the triple position, but there he goes as well. Skadoodle is still here, using Molotovs, trying to slow down these plays. Kishima's on fire! No, he's not. He's getting sprayed, and he's dead. Shroud around Connector and automatic in jungle as well. Two AWPs on this potential retake for Cloud9.
This is a really hard one to call at this point. FaZe can still go back. They do not have to commit. And this is one of the reasons why mixing in fast plays can be so good. Because if it does put you in a weird spot like this, you have time left over to do a lot. And if players are dead for the CTs, suddenly they have to cover so much ground with so few players. And you can start to see it on the minimap now. Start to see Cloud9 dispersing a bit because they have to consider now that it could be actually a B rotation. FaZe, however, have just held their positions instead. And Cloud9 have actually taken more of a... They'll be quicker to respond to A than they will B. Not over-investing in that. That's going to pay off. Cloud9, Skadoodle with the first kill there, spotting Kerrigan. And that will bring the rest of the Cloud9 players back to A.
Yep, second player spotted with the AK. So that pretty much gives the game up for FaZe. 25 seconds remain. And indeed, we've still got a crossfire here for the CT side. The flash coming out and it's going down one by one. Ali's got a lot of work to do. And he's worth getting traded in this situation, even if he can get the kill. He knows where Shroud is, but he knows where Skadoodle was as well. Still wants the one versus ones. And there it is. Shroud goes down. Needs to plant the bomb. He's committing to it. But he knows where Skadoodle is. Skadoodle facing! And he'll get the kill. Cloud9 just retaining this. Alu ever dangerous, even on his own.
Yeah, this is turning into a very close affair. But now FaZe's money has been broken well and truly, leaving them with not a lot in the way of options. Alu, or rather, Rain has the ability to drop some pistols for his teammates. But beyond that, not a huge amount that FaZe are going to offer in this round. Cloud9 can start to make some inroads into actually developing some stability in getting that economy going. And we're going to see FaZe just going for a straight up B push, it seems. Ooh, that's a nice entry from AZ. Picks himself up a cheeky Deagle headshot.
And the team are committing behind it as well, but it still needs to get through the choke point. Flashbang's coming in. Automatic's on the side though, holding things down. Can FaZe get the bomb down in this situation? They're getting cut to ribbons at the moment, but Escudillo, that's an AWP that can be collected, and there's a man advantage for FaZe. Oh, the open plant's not working out. Ali took a gamble. Bomb on the floor now. Rain still reduced to a deagle. No Kevlar on these final two players. They got Karrigan as well. Rain focusing on the wrong corner, and Cloud9 will survive that scare.
That was a massive scare. That was almost a lost round and an AWP given away. But it will not be for FaZe.
Oh, that is grotesque. That's magnificent.
I love that. So good. So good. 4-3 as Cloud9 do indeed start to get a bit of a lead. But they did take quite some damage. Have to see how well they can manage things going forwards. Got just pretty much basic stuff coming in from Cloud9. A bit of a default from them as their opponents as well. You've got AZ here with Karrigan in top mid, just trying to clear some space using the smoke grenades, just trying to pressure off Cloud9 from these more forward spots in middle. And then that will open up a lot of options. That said, it does feel as though they want to get that split onto the A bomb site here. They have presence on slope as well as Palace.
Three people in that middle area. Maybe looking for a mistake from Cloud9, a search for information. The re-smoke into the CPR position. Nothing can Stewie, playing very close to connector. He's got connector smoke coming in now. That might ruin the timing. Combined with the Molotov as well, causing problems for FaZe. FaZe got to be careful of any players peeking from the short position, but no Cloud9 players want to get isolated there. They're playing deep in towards the B bomb site. And again, nothing to the round jungle. Now Kishima's emerging for the pick there. Stewie to K's also around the jungle. And Skadiddle will look to go crossfire. Down goes Stewie though. Skadiddle's on his own. What does he do in this situation?
Oh, he's going to be dinked as well. They're just throwing all the bullets in there. Pop flash play can't come to fruition as he is gunned down. Nowhere left to turn. Lovely stuff here from FaZe. Really good work to neutralize Skadiddle in that position and essentially put themselves in a spot where they shouldn't be able to lose a round from this position. You can see Osmani just desperately wants to save the AWP. And he should be able to do that. He's got Shrouds covering the back, but here comes FaZe as well to eliminate those saving players.
Yeah, Kishima would have heard all the noise that was being made. Trying to run destruction now while Karrigan's going for the bank. That hasn't worked out though. And looks like those weapons will be saved from Cloud9. FaZe don't have all the money in the world either, so they definitely need to hold on to things for the coming rounds, as you can see there. So very difficult Mirage for both sides so far.
It's rather topsy-turvy at the moment. And that's what we like to see.
I love that fast play we saw in the previous round from FaZe, because that was something that Kishima was notorious for, just running into connector and just shooting people in the face. And you saw him doing that around the connector area just then. So we have a pause in at the moment. I think it's a tactical timeout from the Cloud9 side. 4-4 at present. And we have the buy coming in from the Cloud9 team. AWP onto Stewie. Skadoodle has $1,900 in the bank. So one would assume he'll take the AWP, although maybe... Okay, Stewie's got a forward spawn towards A, so I think he might be going for a pick towards the ramp. Nope, having a pick there, moving on towards connector. So I think it is a spawn-based play, and there it is. Ooh. Pays off in spades.
That is nice from Stewie. Very fine shot to hit. Not much time to react to that one. FaZe, it's an interesting spot. They have all the nades still. What is their interpretation? A lot of teams in this spot, because they haven't gained any info or forward presence towards mid, it then becomes kind of risky to try to do it. And this is one way to do it, just taking a risk, cutting a corner, and saying, you know what, let's just push one guy in there. But otherwise, a lot of teams at this point will go, okay, you know what, let's just go for a set piece on one of the bomb sites. And it looks like FaZe will pick B.
But Stewie is already over there. He's being extremely active, has a read that they will try and avoid the AWP, and he will position himself accordingly. But he's really committing to this, bearing in mind Skadiddle only has the USP in this round. If Stewie goes down, this AWP is probably not going to be retrieved, but he's expecting to deliver with his skill, and he'll do exactly that. The AWP rears its ugly head once again. What do FaZe do now? Do they commit to the split here? Another tag through the wall. Stewie causing huge problems, FaZe. They've got no answer.
That is a nice answer, but again, the tag left him so low. AZ finally gets a kill, capitalizes upon his luck, and this is going to cause the bomb to be able to move back into a completely free bomb site. What a round we're witnessing here. Great AWP work from Stewie did so much damage, yet still, FaZe actually can move into this with somewhat of an advantage despite being a man down. They have a post plant, 2v3, and AZ, he's going for the sneaky business. Behind enemy lines, catches a free frag onto nothing.
Oh, he spots a player on short as well, that's Shroud, but does he realize it automatically made his way towards CT spawn? Oh, look at that rotation! Karrigan's going for the hero rotation all the way around continental Europe into the middle area where the bomb is planted, and there's no way automatic can hold a defuse here. And now Karrigan's going to be there, but will he get there in time? Will they read where he is? The taps are coming in! Goes for the duel with automatic as well, but I'm not sure if he's got time to defuse the bomb. It's going to be a close one!
I don't think he's got this. I don't think he has this. Oh, no way. How did FaZe win this round? And what a ballsy rotation coming in from Karrigan there. And at the same time, automatic killed him immediately. Unbelievable stuff. And FaZe managed to pull that one out of nowhere.
That is quite the crazy round. Look at all the effort Stewie put into this. He put his team in such a strong position. But FaZe Clan just outmaneuvered them around the boards. And then there was no time for automatic. No defuse kit, no hope. FaZe Clan in the lead.
Bomb That's left, a great round.
Bomb left in a passive position. Two players early towards A. Normally makes this quite likely to be an A split. Maybe FaZe Clan focusing on showing presence towards B for the time being.
Let's see if they can actually make sure that they can avoid any accidents. Kiyoshima, no accident there. Pop flash into a frag. One by one, they are going to try to uproot these CTs from their scary positions. But that said, there's a bit of activity in middle there for Cloud9 now. But can they get any damage done? It was great. That's a last round. It's great to see that mid-round calling, because that was an instant decision to go to A there. Oh, what a round.
How long will FaZe wait to move into a bomb site? It's an anti-eco round. Alu is leading the charge, looking for a pick opening. 40 seconds on the clock. Fortunately for FaZe, the A bomb site is empty. Ooh. Great to see a Molotov in Sandwich.
There's Molotovs everywhere, James.
Yeah,
that was three Molotovs to clear out close, dodgy positions. Is this the same FaZe? This is definitely not the same FaZe that I'm used to seeing. That's great.
Running into stacks and such. So far, so good. Nice anti-eco round from FaZe, looking to extend their lead a tiny bit. We're looking at the third round of loss bonus for Cloud9, which would be $2,400. Still have about $4,400. We'll see what they choose to do with their money once this round has come to its natural conclusion.
This was definitely a very a good anti-eco round from them. I mean, there's a bunch of approaches you can have, but this was a very good, a slow approach in, you know, all things considered. Even though they're a little bit spread out, they did it in sort of the right ways there. And they came together at the end, and they used Molotovs. Can't ask for too much more. 6-4 now for them, and they have put Cloud9 in a really awkward predicament because they have to go for the buy, but they don't really have enough money for an AWP or for incendiary. They've got one kit on Skadoodle. So this is a really poor situation for Cloud9. They could really lose grip of the map here, and Rain is charging through connector here, looking to find an entry frag. Nothing spots him, misses a lot of shots, does get the kill in the end, however, but FaZe, they march forwards.
Yeah, but they are cutting corners. FaZe just exposing themselves to jungle, throwing a Molotov. That is very messy indeed. And this might be a case of missed opportunity. Now AZ is the only man standing, and they've only got one kill. That is, well, AZ still alive. So let's not count them out just yet. AZ, one of the most consistent players on the team, but this might be too much to ask. 5 HP now, three players coming in his direction. And I think that was just, that looked sloppy to me from FaZe.
Like, yeah.
You can't run through connector with a Molotov in your hand to Molotov triple and get shot from jungle. That's not something that should happen on the T side, I don't think.
Yeah, it was a little bit slower as well, that rush than the last one. You can see that they really struggled to get into position, more forward position, and then they kind of got stuck. And I think there were a lot of awkward decisions to be made, and that's, you can easily get very stuck there, and that's exactly what happened. And Cloud9 capitalized, and Cloud9 were in a position where their backs were against the wall there. If they would have lost that round, they would have had nothing in the following round except for maybe a few pistols. And this forward position, this setup, It's something Fnatic, the old Fnatic, used to do quite a lot, but you would actually do it with a third man in connector as well. So this is a less safe way to do it. But that's okay. Cloud9 will not be challenged in middle. So this mid setup from them, it's not going to help them too much just yet.
Kishima now on the harassment game towards B. 1 minute on the clock, and it's starting to look like another raw play into one of the two bomb sites. Alu has gone to collect the bomb in place of Karrigan, who's moving into the mid lurker position. So there are 45 seconds left. We've got two players towards A. We've got Kirishima and AZ maybe suggesting a fake towards the B bomb site. And I think top mid, and again Karrigan gets picked, and almost a mirror to that previous round. But would a split come fast enough?
Oh, nice peeking and tapping from nothing, very controlled. And that's AZ gone. I don't know what else can be done here by FaZe. They have to be successful on this bomb site take. First frag comes in, and actually the bomb site will be taken. They have it under control, but it's a 2v4. No nades left here for FaZe. AZ, or rather Rain and Alu left against everyone almost of Cloud9. And Rain maybe with the first one-on-one. This could be a good start if he wins this battle. And he sees the barrel of the gun. He's got the advantage. Will he get the frag though?
Shroud still shoulder picking, just buying time for his teammates to rotate. There's a flank coming in from T-Spawn, but so far so good for FaZe. They're well positioned as well. Skadino in no man's land, and nothing. The lurker from T-Spawn is the last man he's going to have to abandon. That is unbelievable. How did FaZe win that round? Shroud was just buying time. He knew there was a player there, which means there's a 3v1 somewhere else, but he's buying time for nothing to come in on the rotation to T-Spawn. But the rest of the team's eye in the meantime.
Yeah, that was awesome again from FaZe. 2v4 there. When all was said and done. And that's another thing about Alu, actually, is that Alu is a player that can play very well with a rifle. An AWPer that can play, very well with a rifle. I can see him able to win the important battles here and pick up an unlikely round. 7-2-5. Is this the time now? Is this the moment where FaZe start to run away with it? Or will there be a shock upset? FaZe, once again, we saw already that they can play a fairly solid anti-eco. This would be the time to see it again.
AZ, Kirishima, and Alu with positions taken up in B apartments. Rain and Karrigan playing passive elsewhere. Alu's just keeping an eye on the mid for the time being. So they're just FaZe covering all the bases in case there's a push from the CTs anywhere. Everything is covered at the moment. Nothing. The only man with a dangerous gun on the Cloud9 side with the AK. Moving through jungle towards the A site where we're seeing two smokes being deployed once again. And this time they're going to move more players in that direction. But the bomb's moving away from the B bomb sites. But FaZe are moving away from A, so I have no idea what's going on right now.
Well, it's time to make a move, and FaZe are going to make the move probably for... Are they going to go for the B split? They have no one left in the A bomb site. Or towards the A-bomb site. Two players in the apartments. This has to be a B play, surely it's going to be B. Although Karrigan is going to make his way into connector, that is obviously a good position to play Lurk from as well. And in they go. They are taking their time about this one. They've got 30 seconds as they're starting to come in. And we see rotation from Cloud9. There's been enough telegraph... they've been telegraphing this enough for Cloud9 to get people in place, but the engagements are just too strong here for FaZe, and they will indeed clean everybody up.
So nothing is on save duty once again. That AK could be very useful in the hands of players such as those on Cloud9. But it may be difficult with the player above his head. He may have no choice but to take an engagement here. I mean, he could gamble that maybe Rain won't peek him. Maybe Rain will. Run nothing. Run as far as he can. He's got a pretty good chance to save it now. Anyway,
he's done well.
Yeah.
Steal the AK away. But what is the situation, James? What is the financial report?
Well, they got that loss bonus reset, so they're going to get all of $1,900 in this round as we move into the dying rounds of the first half. So life is not great for Cloud9.
They might buy with the AK save. Yeah, I think they're going to go for it. This is an interesting spot because Cloud9 have had a few rounds like this where they kind of have to buy. But they're not going to be happy about it. And you can see that they're able to scramble together just enough in the way of grenades here to make this look fairly respectable. So nothing actually saving that AK, that did the world of good here for Cloud9's buy.
Again, Alu using those spawns to go for the B play in earlier New Mirage, you often saw people going for the mid jewel, but the B player is quite favored. Azir going down in middle area. Now Shroud's in trouble with the Famas. Down he goes. There's automatic as well. Skadoodle's in position though with the AK, and he'll get traded by Alu. And there's still potential though for Cloudline. They're not really in position. Nothing, still in connector now, just emerging towards short.
Now it's just about coordinating the remaining two plays and picking your timing perfectly. That's why Stewie was waiting. Now he launches himself through the window, but two frags immediately there for FaZe. They deny the entry, the re-entry for the CTs, and FaZe are 9-5 now. They could even get to 10 rounds. That would be an amazing first half to have, especially considering that they are going to be very strong, I think, on the CT side as well.
That would be nice. Into the last round of the first half. The pistols, the UMP onto Shrouds. A few defuse kits here and there. But indeed, Cloud9 at the mercy of their opponents. Nothing, having a look around the connector position. Nice, see some 5-7s out. Not for long though, as he will get headshot not once but twice by AZ.
FaZe are waiting for that pick in the apartments as well. Just waiting. And whilst they're doing that, you can see Karakhan's being so active here, flashing his teammate into short. He's going to be able to take control of and care of connector. Now they found themselves on B. It's ripe for the taking. And that is exactly what they will be doing. 5-2, a last round of the first half. Stewie is now alone, and he's got to try to do it with CZ. Good luck, my friend.
I love B splits with a smoke over on connector, so you can't be seen from A. I would love to see more of those. So please, please go ahead and do that. 10-5 in favor of FaZe. Cloud9, it wasn't a great half for them, but they have got themselves enough rounds at least to have a fighting start in the second half. So by no means is this game over. Everybody but Karrigan in double figures for FaZe. Karrigan was putting himself in the least useful position in lurker roles, etc., to allow his team to do the work as an endgame leader will often do. So that's not really a big deal. It's expected, in fact. Pistol time. Alu going to be looking towards middle on his own. He's got Kirishima for support. Other than that, the B bomb site's been abandoned. Karrigan's gone for a push all the way through Palace, as you can see here. Lots of information being looked for. And he could take nothing off guard, because nothing's not going to expect CT to be over here.
Oh, he gets the drop on nothing, but he does not get the kill, the headshot. Now, that's going to be a tough start for FaZe, because I mean, that was the information play. Now the information has been silenced. And there is a dark spot, as an unknown in how the movement is for the T's at the moment. So FaZe is going to have to rely on the headshots from some of these passive positions. And they're trying to do their best, you know, having more presence in middle, which will give them, it will be kind of somewhat of a warning system. But you can see Alu might be the guy to get the most action. That said, Rain picks off a player in the flank. So now there's a real chance for FaZe.
Alu spotting one, Shroud capitalizing on this. Oh, look at that headshot, that's disgusting! There goes Shroud as well, time to reload and time for the team to rotate. Spots the bomb onto Skadoodle as well. And we've got nothing, unable to support his teammate, moving through the middle area. Moving towards connect, but Rain's surely going to spot him from shorts. Where is he? We'll see the jewels coming in now. Skadoodle's rotating, but it's the gauntlet play to try and run through that without the bomb being dropped off. Smoke going towards CT, Skadoodle getting tagged. And the bomb just about making it through connector.
Yeah, 15 seconds of plant though. They can't afford anything to go wrong. Their health is very low. And you have to go for the plant. It's not going to happen. AC says no. And nothing. There's not really much he can do in this situation. 11-5. FaZe with the CT pistol. That is going to feel amazing. All they have to do now, James, is stop the Tech Knights. That's all they have to do. That's all they need to do.
Karrigan getting picked off was like in the olden times when you sent a messenger and the recipient didn't like the message, so they sent the horse back with nothing but the messenger's head. That's how I would roll back in the day.
Good times.
Even a milkman, I'd take his head off as well. AZ moving up the middle area. Ooh, warning shots from the Deagle, and AZ's like, you know what? I think I'll pass. Ali's got to be careful though. If he sticks too close to the window, he could be in trouble. Spots one player, and he'll raise the alarm for his teammates. But again, they don't really want to overextend in a situation. And now they'll see loads of players in the middle area, and they'll kill a bunch of them. But again, they need to keep that weapon out of the hands of Cloud9. Even to try and retrieve it now would be risky. They have no HEs to nade the gun to themselves. So have to keep an eye on that. In the meantime, ouch.
Oh. Ouch. Splat. Well, Deagle collected by Skadoodle. Don't know how long he'll be able to hold on to it, though. I've shot a Deagle. It is very difficult to shoot accurately. It's very, very difficult in real life, that is, to shoot accurately. Now, Skadoodle has been discovered. And he will be finished off, as will the round. That's great for FaZe. I mean, they didn't falter to the initial purchase of pistols. It wasn't really a full investment from Cloud9 of the fullest degree, as Skadoodle did hold on to some cash, but it more or less was as close as you otherwise would get. So that's a good pickup for FaZe. They don't have to worry about anything in this round. They should be able to get to 13-5 without too much issue.
Glocks. And one flashbang. One flashbang to rule them all. The final flashbang. If they throw it over the top, well, Carrigan might be in trouble. See if he can avoid it. Indeed, he can avoid it. The spray down the garden hose. The weeding of the plants. And they will all be exterminated. Will Carrigan get the ace?
Give me the ace.
Oh my god, he's got the ace down. He's got 5 kills.
Oh my god.
Everyone's dead because of Carrigan.
Nice. Well, this round's going to basically be the make or break. That's for sure. Cloud9's best chance, probably. Can they get something out of it? I mean, the thing that they have going for them is that FaZe have decided to go for... Well, decided to retain 3 UMPs to basically play very economically minded. And it is a risk, but it's okay because you know if you lose the round, if you win the round, you're set to win the game. If you lose it, you're screwed. And here comes the push. Now, kill here for Rain. And they are locking, Rain is locking down Connector from the bomb site. But they have to be able to hold down the site here. There's 3 UMPs left, and they're getting all the kills. This is fantastic stuff for FaZe. Their gamble has worked off, it's paid off massively.
That is a monster round from FaZe. UMPs for days. Some players think the UMP is possibly overpowered.
It is overpowered.
Leave your comments.
It's $1,200, Jake.
Somewhere.
It's $1,200. It's so good.
Yeah, people never buy an MP7, really. I say never. They rarely buy it.
It's very rare, yeah.
An MP7. Cloud9 with a force buy. 2 Galils coming out. Pistols here and there. They can no longer afford to lose any rounds FaZe require. But 2. Cloud9 need a lot more than that. That range is not favorable. For Stewie. Maybe he can find Aze though. Rain, I think he was deliberately blocking that smoke to give him some fighting space around triple. There goes Stewie, there goes nothing. And more may follow. Hazy, heavily tagged though, will get picked off. And now there's potential for Cloud9 with Rain going as well. Ali's got all of 4 HP and their weapon is to collect.
So actually this is a little bit awkward, but health is getting low. The CT is assigned to coordinate themselves into multiple avenues of attack. Shroud's in the open here. Oh, that nade did some damage. That's meaty stuff. Now, Skadoodle, can he help Shroud out here? Because Shroud is not going to be able to do much with 5 HP, 1 bullet, and he's dead anywhere. Take the bullet to the toe, and he would die. There it is. It's all over there for Shroud and Skadoodle. 15-5, and there's 1 buy left. FaZe have almost $16,000 on Carrigan. He's got an auto sniper, James. He's going in. All the way in.
I don't feel like the auto sniper often yields that many kills compared to how often it's bought on this particular map, but we'll see what Cloud9 can do. AZ and co looking to overwhelm these players. Pop flash here from AZ and he will peek, but will he find? There's something to find. A chance for Cloud9. We've got nothing lurking in the palace. Meanwhile, Stewie's got a very forward position. This is the blind spot I often talk about where people don't expect the team to pop up from. Kishima, though, from out of nowhere, shutting down the B bomb site. There goes automatic as well. 3 versus 3.
And this is where Alu gets very dangerous. He's very, very good. Never mind. I won't even build him up now anymore because he's dead. That's a sad shame there for Alu and his team. But not a sad shame for Cloud9. As they are looking to take the round here, Kiyoshima not able to do much, I don't think, with 19 points of health. Let's see what he's able to get up to, though. Maybe an extra frag at least. But the money should still be great here for the side of FaZe. Oh, it's not really as great as you would have liked to have seen it, and I guess some of that does come down to the ambitious purchase of the auto sniper.
Yeah, it definitely was ambitious.
Yeah, it's not often going to be amazing. Not often. I think it's often better, just generally.
I feel like the auto sniper might get you a second kill if you're playing CC on A towards it's, ramp.
Yeah.
But I don't expect it to get much more than that.
If you think it's really likely they're going for a set piece, it's great through the smokes. On that toll booth position, when you're smoked off, you can get a lot of work done with it.
I'm glad nothing dropped the auto sniper as well, because the problem with having it on the T side is that if it falls back into the hands of the CT side, it has a lot more potential. It is map dependent as well, but generally speaking, you don't want to be carrying an auto sniper on the T side of a map. So Cloud9 nine rounds behind their opponent, but they have the opportunity to break FaZe, who've gone all in with two AWPs.
Now Lou, looking for that pick, smoked off. I mean, it's often going to happen, but you got to check just in case they don't do it. Forced to reposition. Cloud9 where they've... Oh, that's a bit smoke. And that is a frag for Alu. That is a big problem. He gets a second one as well. That's an even bigger problem. It is just compounding at this point, James. There's only two players left against five for Cloud9. And they are around. They can't afford to put a foot wrong here. Automatic's able to take down Kiyoshima, but more work has to be done. Alu, what is this? Surely not. Oh my goodness, that is just magnificence there from Alu. The Finnish sniper. Wonderful. What do you do? What do you do against this, James?
It's one of the most awesome frags I've seen. Skadoodle avoids the flank for a second that was on his way, surely to bring him certain doom, but it'll be AZ to deliver the final blow. 16-6, FaZe take it over Cloud9. A dominating scoreline once again.
Yeah, I didn't necessarily expect to see be so dominant. Obviously, I felt like they had the edge, but Cloud9 could never really get all that much going. Of course, it all started off and it looked like it could be a really close game. It was very backwards, very forwards, and we saw a good look out of Cloud9, but then FaZe just started to take edge over edge, and I think individual skill was firing off a lot better across the board here for FaZe, but they also stole away some crazy rounds, like that round where they were 2v4 going for the B play, and Stewie had amazing AWP frags. That round was amazing.
Yeah, that 2v4 was a pretty crazy round. Strad did his best to buy time, but the time didn't work in their favor, unfortunately. Yeah, that was a very good round, a good confidence boost for FaZe, and as again, a team who are going from strength to strength with Carrigan underneath him is a very good scoreline for them to have as well.
Yeah, I can't wait to see, you know, the general progression of this team, because they keep seemingly getting stronger and stronger all the time.
Yeah, they are indeed, and we will get to see them develop more in this tournament. Although no one's out of it just yet, but of course it's not a good start for two of these four teams we have seen so far. The winners, I believe, are going to play each other in the next match as well. So, yeah, it was pretty good stuff for FaZe, and Cloud9, the bumpy road continues to be bumpy, I suppose.
Yeah, I think, are we ready for the analyst now? Is it time, James? Is it that time?
They say it is, so over to Red Eye.
Indeed, thank you very much, Dan and James, obviously, with games one and two. We'll see him again shortly for game three, which will be our final game, of course, in Group A. We're back on the analysis area with Fiflaren and with Janko. We'll start with the first one, and we'll just briefly talk about the Astralis game. A good win for them, Janko.
Yeah, a very good win. As I said, out for blood for revenge after that E-League finals, and you could see that the map suits them, right? They have a good upper in device, they have a lot of great tamers, and when you have your entry fragger playing super well, having a great game like Dupree obviously had against Optic, it just makes it so much easier, right? You get advantages everywhere, and in that type of a scenario, it's really hard for Optic to fight Astralis.
Fiflaren, it wasn't straightforward at the start. It was a bit messy from Astralis. Dupree, I think, was 6-0 after three rounds. They should have won round three, lost that one, but they've ended up winning 16-7. That's a big win.
Yeah, but this is what I was talking about coming into the game with the vetoes and how best that once I played out. When you have the opportunity to just veto off the maps you don't play, and Astralis has been looking shaken on Cobblestone, they don't necessarily play it. Nuke as well, which they vetoed during E-League. And then they had to pick between Cash and Dust2, and I feel like it was very given that it would be Dust2. Like Janko was saying, they have some great players on that map. And for Optic, I don't know. We're talking about this whole thing about, like, you know, it's the first game of the tournament. It's a best of one. Anything can happen. But you can clearly see there, and this was what basically was supposed to happen during E-League, where it's like you have the favorite, so to speak, and then you have the dark horse, right? Mm-hmm. You can clearly see there, Astralis completely outplayed Optic. It was a little bit rough in the beginning, but I think in the beginning of the tournament, that's somewhat what happens. But then they just ran away with it.
They took a small gamble in vetoing Train over Dust2. I mean, a gamble. They had to know that if they leave Dust2, that's going to be the map that will be played. So they don't want to face Astralis on Train, and Train is a better map for Optic than Dust2. But it's a matter of, okay, let's not play their maybe even the strongest map. Let's try our chances on Dust2.
You see that from again and again teams, especially when it's back-to-back tournaments, they end up losing versus a specific team on a specific map instead of then going back, because Optic is really good on Train. You saw that as well. They completely destroyed FaZe on that map. They've had good results. End up losing just one time, and then instead of just going back, it's like, what do we lose on? Astralis is a great team. It shouldn't really matter. And then fix those mistakes. Come in with a better plan instead of, you know, okay, we don't want to play it to just beat us on it. We're gonna pick Dust2. It's gonna be a gamble. Hardly ever that works out, right? Just go back, see what went wrong. You know you're good on the map. Maybe there was just some minor detail that maybe went missing there on that map, and then you could have had a much more, maybe even more, a more even game.
Game two, Mirage. FaZe have come through against Cloud9, Yanko. Almost disappointing for North America at this point. We're starting to build up these storylines of maybe we're entering the realms of a new era of 3D versus complexity 10 years on from the domination that those two teams gave with Optic and C9 winning tournaments this year. And then straight out of the box, both of them are in the lower bracket.
Seems like more than anything else, Cloud9 were really slow off from the gates, like very slow start. They win Pistol, but they lose the second round. Same thing happens in the second half. They have a bad start, basically losing both pistols in a sense, and that combined with a couple of, you know, weird rounds, the 4v2 that they lost as well, it just shows you that probably their communication wasn't on point. They weren't as focused in this game, and they weren't really playing proactive Counter-Strike. They were playing super passive, which is also not something that Cloud9 is known for, it at least in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, when they won Pro League, the one thing Cloud9 had going for it was the same we were talking about Optic, about very aggressive play style. They have the aimers for it. You go in, you brute force your way in, you use those aimers that you have to your advantage, but you hardly ever saw that here. Even on the second pistol, they end up getting the entry on Kerrigan. What happens? Yeah, okay, just gonna cause rotation. Instead, passive again, they end up dropping men one by one, and then it's a 4-on-2. They have to try and go for the bomb plant on the A bomb side. Not even any coverage, and they end up losing rounds like that. And that's something hardly ever saw their Pro League. But after that, you saw, after that tournament, you see this dip again, which is, I don't know, it always seems to happen for North American teams. Like, yeah, you know, you're expecting so much. Yeah, they did great during Pro League. And then all of a sudden you go into a tournament like this and they end up losing rounds that they should not be losing. And then they end up playing the way that they played during Pro League. It's not what you saw here today. It's not what you saw the past tournament as well. That it's changing styles when in reality you don't need to. You should be focusing on your strengths and play thereafter. And you did not see that.
Mm. Yanko, you've got a clip for us?
I have. It's one of the example of, you know, Cloud9's maybe a bit more passive play. It's a typical round on Mirage where we always talk about mid control and how it's super important. And this round is an example of how Cloud9 gives up mid control, which is not like the end of the world, but you need to do something else on the map if you're going to give up mid. And they didn't go for that. They were actually playing pretty passive throughout, and you can see how they lost mid control in the beginning, and look where all the players are. Like, Kerrigan is on Cat, two players are in Connector, they have control all over the map, and they didn't have any contact with the CTs as of just yet. So that gives them a good idea of where their opponents are. They're playing pretty passive, and the problem here is that even though Stewie was towards B, I think they were making a gamble that actually FaZe is going to go B. That's one of the things you can do. You give up all map control and then you just stack blindly and try your best. But it doesn't work out for them. FaZe goes A, and here nothing challenges, and they lose two kills early on for nothing pretty much, and the round just falls apart. What you want to go for basically, if you give up mid control, you want to try and take map control somewhere else. Either play a bit more aggressive towards ramp, maybe try and get more information in B app so you can rotate the rest of your team appropriately. And here, as you could just see, it's pretty easy. Like Kyo sneaks through the smoke, gets the kill on nothing, then he gets the kill on Stu as well. Two 1v1 duels after more than a minute passed into the round, and you just lose from that. It's not something that you really want to do. If you play passive and give up control, then give it up completely, let them plant the bomb and then play for the retake. But Cloud9 didn't even have that much utility left. They only had flashes, I believe, and one Molotov on one incendiary on Skadoodle, which is not really enough. So an example of how if you give up too much, especially on Mirage, you're gonna have a really, really hard time defending the bomb site.
Man of the match is Alu. We'll take a look at one of his clips in a moment.
Nothing to do with the fact that Tommy is finished as well.
I was going
to
say, Tommy's back in the truck right now watching it going, yeah, absolutely, why wouldn't it? Who would it be? Who else would it be, right? Had to be Alu in this game.
He was actually telling me a story that he had a conversation with Alu right before the game, and Alu predicted they would get 10 T rounds, and then they would win the pistol and only get 5 CT rounds and would lose the game.
Does he know next week's lottery numbers at all?
I'm not sure. I mean, he was close with the 10 T rounds. They got that. They won the pistol, they won the pistol. But you know, at least they ended up finishing off the game, right?
Joking aside, it's great to have a player like Alu. He's flexible. He can play many positions. He can fill in when other players are maybe not having the best of days. Doesn't seem to have that many bad days either now. Much more consistent.
I think that with the addition of Kerrigan, because Kerrigan, his play or his calling style is very loose, right? You know, that's the difference for Astralis now with Glaive. It's a little bit more structured. I think that really fits Alu in the way he plays, where it's like he has a good spawn, maybe Kerrigan can call something, but he would just instantly be like, actually, I'm going to do this. And Kerrigan's okay with that, because he wants that loose play style. He wants people to try and go for picks in the beginning.
But on the other hand, Robin, he's also brought structure to the team that wasn't there before. But it's because they were very loose. They were all over the map.
It's a different kind of loose, though. So like when you have a face with an in-game leader, what's going to happen is that, yeah, it's Pug style, right? Yeah. It's like, yeah, maybe you get the entry. That's great, because you have the aimers, but what do you do with that? That's when Kerrigan comes in. It's like, okay, great. Who did you get? You got the long guy. Okay, perfect. You know who it is. Then you do something with that. That's something that FaZe didn't really have before. Yeah. Where it's like that execution kind of style. It's like, yes, roam the map in the beginning, try and go for picks, and we'll work from there. Before, it was just like, go for picks. Okay, I'm going to go for pick B now. And it's like, okay, maybe if you're lucky, yeah, you're going to get to him. It's a 5-on-3. Perfect, right? Chances are you're not going to lose the round.
Much cleaner.
Yeah. Definitely so. It's also a matter of if the picks are not working initially or the loose play style, then you also have something to fall back on. Okay, let's try this execute then, maybe this will work. And they also had great change of pace in the first half. We saw that example of a slow, methodical, let's take mid, but they also had a good half of a rush towards A through connector, and that really keeps the CTs guessing all the time. You have to constantly adjust, and they always take the game to you, which is something, in my opinion, you always want to go for ST.
All right, thank you very much, gentlemen. We are headed towards a break right now, but just a reminder for you, coming up after the break, we do of course have the matchup that we've been waiting for. That's right, Kerrigan finally gets a chance at a shot at his old teammates. We'll see you after the break.